Spiral Media presents The Flash Rewatch.
I think you've been reading too many comic books.
Dedicated to the 1990 television series The Flash on CBS.
I think I'm starting to like this.
Join Cory and Tom each week as they chase down the fastest man alive and examine the short run of 22 episodes.
I mean, you people have a reputation. Unorthodox experiments, secret government contracts.
Send us your feedback at goldenspiralmedia.com/feedback. Like our Facebook page at facebook.com/rewatchpodcast. And follow us on Twitter at rewatchpod.
Anytime you need me, I'll be there in a flash.
And welcome back to the Rewatch Podcast and the Flash 90 Rewatch. I'm Corey.
And I don't even know who I am.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Time for your medicine.
My medicine.
Yep.
My medicine?
Time to record another podcast, all right? So let's get going.
Yeah, podcast. I remember the shows.
Very good. Let's begin. Thank you for joining us, everybody.
Yeah. Thank you all. Happy to be here, I think.
Well, let's hope you remember the episodes. We're here to discuss two more episodes of The Flash 90.
Yes.
This week, we are discussing Beat the Clock and The Trickster. And we're going to do it a little bit differently this week, actually.
Yes.
We're talking about Beat the Clock first, but for The Trickster, we're going to have two very special guests.
Yep. You gotta hang on, you'll find out.
Yeah, listen through, wait for it. Anticipation, that's what it's all about.
Exactly. And it's not gonna be our impressions of Sean Connery or, Vincent Price or anything like that. It's actual special guests.
Yes, we'd want to hope so. All right. Well, before we get into it, let's remind our listeners we're part of the Golden Spiral Media Podcast Network. You can send us your feedback at goldenspiralmedia.com/feedback, where you can type out a message. Or use the SpeakPipe widget right there on the right-hand side to record your own voice, or you can call 304-837-2278. Plenty of ways to get in contact with us. And also head over to facebook.com/goldenspiralmedia and follow on Twitter at GSMPodcasts. All right, let's get into the first episode discussion today. The episode is Beat the Clock, written by Jim Trombetta and directed by Mario Azzopardi. This originally aired on January 31st of 1991.
I know you. You're the guy they call the Flash. What are you doing here? What do you want with me?
Some people I know think you're innocent. I'm here to help you.
Well, thanks, but it's a little late for that.
I don't think so. But I need to hear your side.
Oh, man, I've been over this, like, forever. Nobody believes me. Man, I loved Linda. She was the best thing ever happened to me, on or off the stage. Man, that night, we fought like cats and dogs. But that was just us. No way I could have killed her. I worshipped Linda. I mean, I was angry that night, man, not homicidal. Later on, I left the club with this girl named Susie Storm. I know it was a stupid thing to do, but I was feeling bad, feeling sorry for myself. We went back to her place, but all we did was talk. We talked about how much I loved Linda. And the next day, Linda's dead, and Susie, my alibi, is nowhere to be found.
But Linda was leaving you. She booked a one-way flight to L.A.
She wasn't leaving me, man. You see, Linda cut her first record for my brother, but she didn't want to do her second album with Elliot. She wanted to get out from under his shadow, you dig? So there was this big-time producer out on the West Coast that said she could do whatever she wanted. The songs, hire the session musicians, everything. But she was coming back. She was coming back to me.
Do Jazz musician Wayne Cottrell is playing his saxophone on death row, waiting as the clock counts down to his midnight execution, the sentence for being convicted of his wife's murder despite his protests of innocence. A last-minute phone call suggests to Barry Allen and Julio Mendez that Wayne actually is innocent, however, and that the tragic killing of his wife, Linda Lake, was actually staged. The Flash retrieves a ruined cassette tape containing evidence that will prove Wayne innocent and enlists Tina's help in reconstructing it. Meanwhile, we learn that Cottrell's brother, Elliot, was actually the mastermind behind the songbird's apparent death. Having learned that she was planning to leave his record label and go off on her own, Elliot planned to hold Linda captive with memory-limiting drugs, yet would also continue to record and release albums as lost tracks, thus ensuring himself a steady income. With help from a bodyguard named Whisper, he framed his brother for murder using one of his obsessed fans as the unfortunate stand-in for Linda's corpse. With the tape reconstructed and having found new evidence that the body was not Linda's, Flash and Julio both attempt to rescue Linda but are put off by Whisper. She manages to make it back to the club on her own, where her memories slowly start to come back. The Flash arrives to get her to the prison where the execution is about to take place, and he's able to save Wayne from electrocution with an instant to spare.
Damn it! 15 minutes away from being home free.
We don't know what else Mendez and his partner have on us.
As far as I'm concerned, those guys are dead.
My pleasure. Elliot, we're gonna have to lose Linda too.
No. She is a gold mine. I'm not throwing it away.
Hey, we've taken this as far as we can. The heat is up, my man. And if you fry, I'm on the burner beside you.
I don't know. Linda's voice built this club.
Yeah, and the minute the record came out, she was gonna leave you and sign with a big label. You made that trap.
She was more mine than she ever was, Wayne.
Yeah, that night she tried to split. You would have beat the life out of her if I hadn't stopped you. Now don't you play sentimental on me. I lived up to my end. I did, Susie. Put her in Linda's car. And you set Wayne to take the fall. Now it's time to do Linda for good. We gotta do it for real.
Okay, let's get into the flashpoints for Beat the Clock. What have you got for us, Tom?
The first thing I noticed was, the name of the club, Take Five. Do you know why they called it the Take Five?
No idea.
There's actually a pretty famous jazz tune that's called Take Five, and it's one of those that I'm sure that if you heard it, I'm sure you, like, if you just heard a clip of it, you'd be like, oh yeah, I've heard that around. It's a pretty popular tune. I think it was the Dave Brubeck quartet that actually put that one out. But yeah, it's a pretty popular jazz tune.
Very cool.
And then I also wanted to say Barry's interest in jazz. It just kind of struck me, kind of like his interest in Mexican wrestling, you know? It's like, really? Oh, I guess, all right, you're into that too.
I mean, that could be. He's eclectic, maybe. He's worldly.
I mean, nothing against John Wesley Shipp, but I look at him and I just think, like, easy listening, you know? Like, he goes back home, puts on some Barry Manilow and, you know, just chills. I don't know what it is. I don't know. I just don't see him as a jazz guy. But hey, everybody has their thing, I guess, right?
It's true. He seems to be a regular over at Take Five as well. So
exactly.
There it is. He loves it.
And then finally, I thought it was kind of neat that they gave Julio a little bit of a backstory here, a little bit of, you know, about his childhood, his growing up, and kind of getting involved with the gang there and how Wayne sort of helped him out. I thought that was neat because we don't get a lot with Julio, really, and to get this piece of his backstory is kind of nice.
And is anybody, like, in this quick connections or anything, you know, with Elliot and Whisper and Linda?
You know, there's not much, but I will say this. Linda Lake... Okay, they have the character of Linda Lake, the jazz singer, you know, and amazing, played by Angela Bassett, by the way. I don't know if you knew that.
Yeah.
But Angela Bassett. So she's, you know, she's definitely, you know, big film star and everything, of course. But Linda Lake is apparently a DC Comics character from Smallville, and I tried looking to see if she was in the comic books, and I could not find a reference to her in the comic books because every search result seemed to result in me coming up with something with Smallville. She was played by Tori Spelling, I think it was, from 90210. And she's basically a gossip columnist for the Daily Planet in Smallville, kind of like Cat Grant was the gossip columnist in Lois and Clark. So I guess that was her thing. But apparently, of course, she was in Smallville at the time of the meteor shower and has special powers and everything. Water powers, by the way, hence the name, okay. Linda Lake. But I'm wondering, like I said, I tried to like backtrack it to an actual DC Comics reference from like the actual comic books, and I could not like get there. I would end up on these disambiguation pages, you know, and it would say Smallville and other media, you know, and then it would go to either, like I said, Smallville, or it would go back to the Flash character that we talk about here. So I'm not sure if she's from the comics. I mean, it's very possible, because Superman has a huge history of characters with LL, you know, as co-stars in his comics. So it's possible she is from the comics, but I could not find anything except the reference to the Smallville character. So we got kind of a connection there.
Well, I mean, it's not, you know, impossible that they took the name from this Flash series and then input it into Smallville.
True.
And that's the only two times that she appears. But you're exactly right. I mean, of all the characters from this season,
right,
they cherry pick Linda Lake and throw her into Smallville.
Yeah, I know. It's just so weird, so strange.
Yeah.
But there is one more thing that you didn't catch. We have one more returning regular in this episode. The priest. Father Murphy, I think it was. No, not Father Murphy. Father, was it
Michael?
Father Michael. Yeah. The priest is back. He's the same character.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. Yep. I didn't even think of that. Of course.
Yeah. Oh.
There you go.
Jazz has never been my cup of soup, but I gotta tell you, this was very cool. All right.
That's good.
Not bad, Wayne, not bad.
Not bad?
Yeah, considering your junior high school music teacher wouldn't trust you with woodblock.
Look at this guy.
This place is absolutely packed. If this keeps up, I won't be able to get in anymore.
Oh, yes you will, Barry. Yeah. There'll always be a table for you and Julio.
Thanks, Linda.
But you may notice a few changes next time you're here, though.
Yeah. After what I went through, all these clocks around here just gotta go. Except that one. Mm. Of course, that one, I can live with.
Mm. What's this?
A new item to the menu in honor of our mysterious friend.
Buffalo wings?
No. Flash wings.
Oh, I get it. Kind of like...
All right, so let's get into the rundown. So, Wayne Cottrell on death row, ready to be executed in 1 hour, accused of killing his girlfriend, singer Linda Lake. Yes. You know, I have to say from the get-go on this episode, I kind of like the idea of, you know, the ticking clock, right? 1 hour to get this done. And I think it lends itself to, you know, Barry having to, like, zip all over the place.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And that's what I kind of like about it, you know, especially because, like, Julio's involved. So, like, when Julio would, like, get in the way of Barry being able to zip over there.
Well, I liked the idea, okay? And I think for the most part, they did a good job. But there were a couple times when I felt like, this is just taking too long. Like it's well past the hour. He's dead already. You know, even though they kept going back to the clocks and showing like that separate scenes, I the way that it was paced out, I thought, yeah, I don't know. I didn't feel the pressure of the ticking clock as much as I think they wanted us to. It felt just a little drawn out a couple times.
Yeah. And I think it kind of goes back to that like convenience thing as well, yeah, a little bit, right? It's not that like Barry knows anybody, although right, right, he does frequent Take Five often.
He does. Whenever he's not at the Mexican wrestling matches, he goes to the Take Five.
And the fact that Julio like knows all the like the owners and everything from his childhood, the fact that somebody calls up to speak to Julio, Dave Buell rings up to speak to Julio about, you know, a recording or something that he has, and Barry just happens to pick up the phone because Julio's not there. I still kind of like that, though, in that, like, the Flash had to race over there super quickly, but it's just, like, just not quick enough to stop that tape from being run over.
When the tape was run over, I was like, okay, well, it's not, like, destroyed. It's just all off of the you know, the middle core of the tape. That's all. I mean, with his super speed, he should be able to, like, just roll that back onto the thing really quickly, you know, and just, like, boom, it's back. When they decided to go ahead and do it digitally, I'm like, computers take forever to do that. I'm like, really? Like,
especially in 1990 or 1991 now, I guess.
I mean, have you ever rendered audio on a computer before? Let me tell you, it takes a while. But aside from that, I was okay with it. I'm like, for the sake of the story, you know, we had to get Tina involved. Otherwise, she wouldn't have been there.
And honestly, I didn't quite understand where they were going with the tape. Because, like, it plays out a bit and you're thinking, like, oh, okay, like, this tape's going to have them, like, confessing or something on it, right? Just, right, like, right. They inadvertently left the record button on. Caught themselves, like, on tape confessing to the murder or something like that. The fact that it ends up playing out, you know, once it's digitally remastered and it's just music and you're like, all right, it's just music. Like, what? And then for it to, like, go even deeper of, like, they were recorded at the same time and that means it was recorded after she was dead, which is impossible. Then she's not dead. I'm just, like, that mystery just... That went down so many layers, right? Like, whoever came up with this idea of, like, you know, we know so much about audio recording and we're going to write a script where a fake murder is revealed as we go down the levels of finding this out. Like, I mean, that's some complex writing there, right?
Yeah, I think it's like, if you're a musician and, like, you know, I think that's where kind of, like, it will hit home if you're a musician. Because if you heard, like, this cool solo, you know, the 1 week, you know, and then you hear it on this supposedly vintage tape, you know, you'd be like, wait a second, that solo's, like, almost note perfect from what I heard last week. I think that's where they were trying to focus on that aspect of it, you know, the fact that the solo or the music was, like, you know, perfect, exactly what they had heard the week before. And that's what I think it was, the focus.
Now, what did you think of Cottrell, our, you know, accused murderer?
I take him or leave him. He was okay. You know, I mean, it's not the best acting I've ever seen. It's not the worst, you know, but it's just, there was something about him that just felt a little bit over the top to me.
I mean, it's going to be hard to sort of be separated from the rest of the story, really, because he's in prison that whole time.
Exactly.
And the fact that he's just always playing the saxophone in his, you know, death row cell.
I don't know how prison works, but do they let you have instruments like that? I guess maybe if you're there for a while, you earn... things, maybe.
Well,
I don't know.
He's about to die as well, you know, last wishes and all that, I guess.
That could be.
But I thought it was funny when the Flash showed up there, because of course Elliot's like, you're the Flash guy, like, what do you want with me? I've already been convicted, right? Like, this is cool. Perry does this thing where he starts talking to Elliot about, like, what's going on and everything, and he sort of puts his leg up on a chair and sort of braces his head with his hand, right? And it's sort of like, you know, all right, let's rap. Something like, I was expecting him to say something cheesy like that to him.
That did stand out to me. I noticed that when he put his leg up. I mean, I didn't, it was nothing like, I was like, oh, I got to mention that. But I was like, yeah, that's just an odd move, you know, just an odd position. What I found interesting was when he gets there, he zooms in and just opens up the cell. Like, it's not locked. Like, he didn't, like, vibrate or anything to, like, undo the lock. He zooms in front of the cell, opens up the door, and then walks into the cell. So he's apparently not under lock and key.
You know, I thought the exact same thing, but then I thought, all right, maybe he swiped the key as he, like, sped into the cell as well. Like, I kind of suspended my disbelief on that, where I was like,
I'll give you that.
That door was just open? What?
All right, I'll go with it.
And then, of course, like, the story unfolding over at the Take Five Club with the brother Elliot and his, like, heavy, I guess.
Yeah.
Whisper. That guy looked familiar. I don't know the actor's name, but I think he, like, appeared in, like, a lot of, like, blaxploitation movies and got involved with, like, I know I've seen him in Rob Zombie films before.
Okay. See, I looked at them all. There was nothing that really stood out to me that was like, oh yeah, he's from that thing.
But, you know, even Whisper got a bit of a backstory, which I wasn't expecting.
Oh yeah.
It's when Wayne's talking to the Flash, and he says about that guy who got his throat slit or something.
Right.
And then I'm like, oh, that's Whisper he's talking about. I'm like, wow, like, random backstory for that guy.
Yeah, as far as like the characters are really pretty well fleshed out. You know, like the guest starring characters are pretty well fleshed out. And like I said, Julio's backstory was nice to have as well. So it's definitely good from that point of view, definitely.
And then Linda Lake, like I was saying, like the twist ending of Linda Lake still being alive, it was a slow burn, but I kind of enjoyed that, you know? I thought it was an interesting twist.
Yeah, this is one of those episodes that just like never really stuck with me. So I couldn't remember what was going to happen. And I thought that maybe Linda was in on her death, you know, and she actually did want to get away from Wayne, and run away with the brother. That's where my mind was. So when I saw her and she was alive, I was like, oh, okay, see, she is still alive and they're going to make these records and get enough money to run off together or whatever. So yeah, it was a twist for me as well.
I don't know if it's a real thing that there's like such a like tranquilizer that gives you amnesia as well.
Yeah, I was wondering about that.
You reckon that's just like something they kind of made up? And just like,
that's hey, just for the
our,
show.
It's, yeah, it's our show. Like, sure, this exists.
Exactly. That's what I think, yes.
Time to take your medicine.
Yeah, I'm with you on that.
Did you also notice that Tina got backhanded again in this episode?
Yeah, by Whisper? I did, yes. When that happened, I was like, we need to start a Tina getting backhanded count. You know, and every time it happens, just ding, you know, put up a number.
I think that's three now.
I was going to say three. I wasn't sure if it was three or four, but yeah, I think it's three. Poor Tina. Yeah. Oh.
And then the big climax. I really thought they were going to go like super cheesy and do like the very like last second countdown. You know, it's like 3, 2.
Right.
Wait a minute. So, you know, the fact that the Flash comes in, like they're pretty much ready to go and they're going to pull the lever.
And they do.
And then the Flash comes in and takes him out. I thought that was really good as well.
Yeah, it definitely shows his speed. Like he's faster than the electrical charge can reach from the lever to the actual chair. So that was a cool scene right there.
But all in all, you know, as standalone episode, I think this was really solid, right? I think, you know, it was good to have the Julio backstory and all the characters that came in, I thought were really interesting. Still surprising me, like you said, with the priest. I was like, oh, cool. Yeah, the priest. Father Michael. I forgot all about that.
Exactly. Yeah, it's definitely not a bad episode. You know, it's definitely it's a good episode. It's just I still think that for some reason it didn't stick with me the first time. I don't know that this is going to be one of those episodes that I think back to and be like, oh yeah, remember that episode with the jazz? I don't know if I'm going to remember this one.
Well, you know, at the same time, I'm going to defend Barry here. I like jazz too. All right. I don't go out and tell the whole world about it, right? I'm not going screaming it from the hills. Hey, I love jazz.
True. Okay.
So I kind of like it from that aspect too. I kind of like saxophone music.
Well, yeah, I have nothing against jazz. Don't paint me as the jazz hater. I like jazz. I'm a musician, so I'm right there with you, you know. I get you. It's fine.
But yeah,
you know,
I'm just saying it's not. This isn't a terrible episode or anything. I kind of like this episode, and it was cool.
I'm there. I hear you. I'm with you.
And now it's time for another episode of Little White Lies with the Trickster.
Mustache and beard are real. Oh, so I lied.
This has been another episode of Little White Lies with the Trickster. Okay, let's get into the second episode discussion today. The episode is The Trickster, written by Howard Chaykin and John Francis Moore, directed by Danny Bilson, and this originally aired on February 7th of 1991.
The red costume, with that lightning bolt insignia signifying his dark power.
Will you listen to this knucklehead?
I just can't believe we gotta haul him all the way to state lockup.
Well, to hell with that! Take me to Central City. That's where this Flash lives, right?
Yeah, there's no justice.
He stole the only woman I ever loved from me.
That's because you murdered the other 12 only women you ever loved.
Flash. He kidnapped her. Brainwashed her with his black science. There's only one man who can stop the Flash.
Hey!
The
There's only one man who can rescue my faithful companion, Megan Lockhart, from the Flash's evil clutches. And I am that man. Move over! I'm driving.
When private detective Megan Lockhart is abducted by James Jesse, a crazed criminal with a knack for the theatrical, the Flash races to her rescue. The madman's run-in and subsequent capture by the Scarlet Speedster serves only to prompt a dangerous obsession, however, as Jesse decides that in order to bring about his superhero rival's downfall and recapture the lovely Lockhart, he requires a new identity, and thus escapes police custody and begins to terrorize Central City as the Trickster. Several tricky encounters later, Lockhart tracks down his hideout on her own, but the Trickster, masquerading as an FBI agent, gets a drop on her, kidnapping Barry as well and placing him in a death trap. Barry breaks out of the trap and decides to prey on the villain's ego to get him to make an appearance at the policeman's ball, where their explosive final showdown results in a captured Trickster at long last.
In my darkest hours, arrayed against my greatest foes, you've always stood by me, Frank, ever my faithful and trustworthy sidekick. What do you think?
Oh, Trickster, it's beautiful. Right now, I'm not feeling too beautiful, because my mind is clouded by the Flash's hypnotic powers.
The fiend! But don't fret, Frank. I'll fight to win you back, even if I have to lay the city to waste.
Oh, Trickster, I love you.
And I, you, with all my heart. To the Trickster Mobile.
Okay, so let's get into the Flashpoints segment for this episode. But before we do, let's welcome our very special guests to the Flash 90 Rewatch. You know them as the hosts of Central City Underground. Well, retired hosts of Central City Underground.
Retired just now. Yeah, we just finished and we're handing it off to somebody else to start in a few weeks with the new season.
Very exciting.
Awesome. So there is someone taking over then.
Well, there's options.
Yes, Daryl is working with a couple of people. So yeah, I'm glad we were able to work it out. Life just got a little too crazy for Joe and I to keep doing it, but there are some really great folks who have been listening to the podcast and I think are going to wind up taking over. So we're excited about that.
Well, awesome.
Well, before we go any further, those voices are Tony and Joe, of course.
Yes.
What's up? Hi, I'm Tony.
I'm not Tony.
Yeah.
Well, I got to say to you guys, I'm a big fan. I've called into your show before with feedback, you know, a couple times.
Oh, you loved getting it. Thanks.
Yeah, Corey, he actually introduced me to you guys. He said, hey, you know, if you're looking for a podcast to listen to about Flash, you know, there's this one. I'm like, all right, I'll check it out. And I was hooked from the moment I started listening.
Oh, you're too kind. Corey, what did we do? We did Die Hard, right?
We did, yeah. Oh, we talked to we did like a commentary of it, right? We watched it and...
Yeah, that was very fun. As we watched it, we did a commentary, like running commentary. That was really fun. So, no, it's great to do this with you guys. Thanks for asking us. It's fun.
Yeah, well, this is kind of our like buffer into Golden Spiral Media, right? The show was picked up by them, and we thought, well, this would be a great way to do it. And, of course, we've got to get you guys on the show. What better episode to do it for? The Trickster, right?
Oh, man.
So fun.
Literally not sure that I have seen it since it aired when I was a wee bairn back in the day.
Yeah, really fun.
All right. So let's do some flashpoints on this, what we got in the background. So Tom's kind of our expert on this. So Tom, what have you got for us in the behind the scenes stuff here?
All right. So right near the beginning, one of the first things, the references they made was to Mandrake the Magician. Are you familiar? Anybody familiar with Mandrake the Magician?
Oh, I'm familiar.
Awesome. Yeah, I'd known of him because I used to watch that cartoon movie, Defenders of the Earth. He was in there with the Phantom, I think.
Yeah, the Phantom and Mandrake and Flash Gordon.
Yes, that's right. That's right. So that was a cool little reference, I thought, Mandrake the Magician, because I'm not sure if a lot of people know. Like, I was looking him up to find some more information about him, and a lot of people count him, Mandrake the Magician, as the really the first superhero. You know, traditionally we think of Superman as like the first superhero, but we had Flash Gordon, the Phantom, we had Mandrake all around before Superman came around. So they sort of give him the props for the first hero, the first superhero.
Very nice.
And then I don't know if you guys caught this, Megan Lockhart, she calls on the phone, says, hey, I know where his hideout is. It's on Margot Lane. Margot Lane is the lady friend of The Shadow, another pulp hero from back in the day.
What? Totally missed that one.
Oh, damn. That's great. Nicely spotted.
Well, now I'll tell you this. I'm not going to take credit for that one. I found that one on IMDb. So full disclosure, I'm not that good. I'm good. I'm not that good, though.
That's awesome.
Look, guys, I got to admit, I just made up a lot of my facts.
There you go. All right, so I don't feel so bad now. Okay, so I can do that. I can just make up stuff, right? That's awesome.
The things I can admit now that it's over.
This one was pretty simple. The Infantino Hotel was on a poster. They mentioned it.
Yeah.
And yet, of course, that's a reference to Carmine Infantino, the famous Flash artist.
Very well-known Flash artist, yeah.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Of course, we couldn't miss the statue of Mercury, the god Mercury, of course, reference to Jay Garrick, Flash.
Right.
And then, now this one. Okay. Sometimes they do weird things. I don't know why they did this, but the prop warehouse that they eventually find him at, it's called the Agit Prop Warehouse, A-G-I-T-P-R-O-P.
I'd noticed that too. What a weird choice.
I know. I was like, what does that mean? I looked it up, and agitprop refers to political propaganda, like communist, actually, political propaganda.
Mostly a communist movement, right?
Yeah. Not the only red in this episode. I felt terrible about that joke the second I made it.
I don't know where that came from. Why did they choose that? That's so odd.
Right? I took the same note, Tom, because I was like, what a weird, of all the things to call it. I'm going to piggyback on your theatrical warehouse, because the other thing that happened that involved theatrical warehouses was Megan was on the phone, and the guy said, yeah, there's got to be 2 dozen of them in town.
Yeah. I'm like, 2 dozen?
What? How many theaters do you got in Central City?
Seriously.
Prop warehouses?
I know.
Hey, well, we've been watching this series through, so we know that they've got, like, Helltown and Spanish Hill, so...
Yeah.
It's not beyond Central City to have, like, a massive theater district as well.
Seriously, though. 2 dozen. Yeah, I took the same note. I was like, 2 dozen? Really? All right. Let's see. I also noticed that so far in Star Labs, we have Tina McGee who works there. We've met her boss. And we have at least 2 security guards, but now we also get a mention of Gibson, who works in cybernetics. We've never seen him, you know, we only ever see Tina, really, but we've got another person working at Star Labs now.
Right, right, exactly.
And now, this one confused me. When Megan comes back to Barry's place and she says to Tina, oh yeah, Barry told me what happens when you don't get a lot of sleep, you know, girl gang. And she's like, I can't believe you told her that. I didn't have any clue what she was talking about. Did you guys?
Nope. I was trying to think if it was from an earlier episode that I
assumed it must have been.
You know, because I haven't watched most of them since the 90s. I assumed it was from an earlier episode. Maybe they shot something out of order and it'll be in an upcoming episode.
You know what? You're on the right track because I did the work so you guys don't have to.
Oh.
It turns out the next episode that we're going to watch, which is called, I think, Tina, Is That You? That was supposed to air before the Trickster episode. So in there, we're going to learn what the Tina's girl gang is.
Oh, man. Now I want to watch the next episode.
It's the worst of when they do that.
And then the final note I had was just a little comment on Tina and Barry's relationship. I feel bad for Tina because I just feel like she really likes him more than he likes her. He's looking at it as like a friendship thing. I think she has a little bit deeper feelings for him.
Oh, she pines.
Yeah. It's like, oh, it's too bad. Because we talked back in the pilot about how Iris was there, and it's a terrible version of Iris. I don't know if you guys remember this Iris from the pilot.
Not at all.
Oh, she was awful. She was like an artsy type, an artist, very flaky. Barry was pining after her, wanting to marry her, and she just sort of put him off at every instance she could. It was... It was a terrible version of Iris. And then she was just gone by the second episode. They wrote her off.
Yeah, they said she moved to Paris and that's it.
Exactly. That was it. Moved to Paris. So we figured they were trying to work on the relationship between, you know, try to have some romantic tension between Barry and Tina. But it doesn't play well. Tina definitely is pining for her, but I just don't feel it on Barry's end.
Yeah, that thing with Barry and Megan and Tina and the jealousy thing there was kind of weird.
Yeah, it was definitely, definitely weird.
Could you imagine a love triangle on a TV show?
I know. How odd.
Well, I'm sure we're going to get into Megan Lockhart's return to this show.
But, yeah, because she had, what, 3 episodes total, right? Were there 2 before this?
No, she's been in 1 so far.
Oh, okay. Maybe she comes back later. Okay, I couldn't remember. I have a flashpoint. I thought it was interesting because this episode in particular was like a reunion of sorts, because in the Flash on the CW that's running now, we've had 5 of those people back on the show.
Yeah.
Oh.
Of course, John Wesley Shipp, who plays Flash in this, plays the dad, Henry Allen, on The Flash now. And Jay Garrick, right?
And Jay Garrick, yep.
Yeah, the one who's not dead, spoiler. And Amanda Pays, of course, on The Flash that's running now, plays Tina McGee, an older version of, you know, we sort of go, it's so fun the way they did this.
Parallel universes are crazy.
They are.
Mark Hamill is back as the Trickster.
That's right.
But also, in this episode, we met Julio Mendez, who came back for 2 episodes at least of the new series.
Yeah, I love that.
Yeah, at first he was Captain Julio Mendez.
Yeah.
In an alternate timeline, he was a jazz musician who got killed by...
Wait.
Touched people, turned them to dust.
It was a guy who didn't have a super secret code name. He just had a name.
Then it was just... killed by random bad guy.
Yeah, Dusty McGee.
That's who it was.
Any relation to Tina?
Distant cousins, but... And then we also got featured heavily in the ridiculous subplot this week of Murphy being the Flash. But Bellows comes back in Flash 2015-2017 as...
Mayor Bellows.
Mayor Bellows.
That's right, yeah.
And the thing that I think is fun about that is they use the same actors for all of those people.
I know, that's great.
So I just had to bring that up because while I was watching it, I was like, I just saw all these guys like 10 months ago. Look at them.
When they start casting Jay Garrick's wife, I wouldn't be surprised if Lockhart shows back up again.
That would be awesome. Oh, that would be awesome. When Julio showed up as the captain, I lost it. And my kids were watching it with me. They didn't know what was going on. But I was like, that's amazing.
Right? Wasn't that fun?
Well, that was great. One little Flash factoid I caught too, and I just wanted to throw out because it just made me giggle. Both Lockhart in the 90s TV show and Joe West in our TV show described the Trickster the exact same way.
That's right.
James Jesse, like Jesse James but twisted. They both said the exact same line.
Oh, that's funny.
Awesome.
I love it.
I ask so little of you, my faithless companion.
Jesse, don't. Maybe we just need counseling.
As my loyal sidekick, you have room for but one man in your life.
Okay, I'll be your sidekick. Just let him go. I don't love him or the Flash.
You love me?
Yes, I love you.
And you hate him?
He means nothing to me.
Then let's kill him.
All right, well, let's get into the rundown of the episode. So, obviously, the quick connection for this one is James Jesse, the Trickster. Now, do you guys know if this is, like, pretty much his, like, backstory as it was written in the comic books, that he was just this deranged, like, murderer, James Jesse, who becomes the Trickster?
Actually, not at all. This one seems to lean a lot closer to, like, the Joker than Trickster. In the comics, the Trickster was the child of circus performers, and he himself performed in the circus for a long time, and he became the Trickster because he was kind of a gadget maker, and he invented, and I think this is literally what he called them, his air shoes?
Yeah,
he invented a pair of shoes that allowed him to walk on air and decided to commit robberies using them, and that's why he assumed the name of the Trickster. But he actually was, as far as sanity goes, he was actually pretty together. He even joined the FBI for a while. He went straight and joined the FBI as a profiler.
Oh, wow.
And mostly what he did was outsmart people. Like, that's the thing James Jesse was really good at, is just outsmarting and tricking people. Including in one of my favorite story arcs, outsmarting the devil himself.
Nice.
Underworld Unleashed?
Yeah.
Yeah. He outsmarted the devil himself.
And in this one, he's just a psycho.
He's just a psycho.
Well, that's kind of what I put together in this, because I know that Megan Lockhart isn't from the comic. She was made up for this TV right. show, so right. obviously it's changed slightly to include her. But yeah, you know, I think at the end of the day, my opinion on the Trickster here is that, like, he is to the Flash what the Joker is to Batman, but he's probably around the Riddler level with the fashion sense of Crazy Quilt, right?
There you go.
That's a great description.
Yeah, good reference.
I do like that line where he says, "Ah, the beard is real." All right, I lied.
So good.
So what do we think of Mark Hamill here? I understand that this was really his creation. Like, this is how he wanted to take the character, right, for the show.
From what I read, he actually campaigned to play the Trickster. Like, he knew about the show. I read this on the Geek Twins website. We mentioned, you know, a couple episodes ago. He was running a comic book shop or something. He knew about the show, and he actually called the casting director and said, "Hey, if you guys have any interest in the Trickster, you know, I've got an idea for that I think might work really well." So he actually campaigned to get that job, which is kind of neat.
Yeah, no kidding. I had no idea of that, and I think that's really cool. It was funny watching this one compared to the 2017 version of Trickster, because in that time frame he went a little more crazy, I think.
Yeah.
You know, even further down the road. And it made me wonder if, because after The Flash was when Mark Hamill started doing all of his voiceover animation
right.
as the Joker for DC. And, you know, like, defined the Joker for DC animation. And then it really felt like that fell right into his performance of the Trickster on the new Flash.
Well, it works so well because, I mean, according to the legends, Mark Hamill was actually the second person they brought in to play the Joker.
Yeah, Tim Curry was first.
Tim Curry was the original voice of the Joker and was apparently deemed too scary.
That's awesome.
Apparently, it's like one of the things people still hunt for is the audio recordings of his version of the Joker, but apparently it was too much.
That's great. But I liked Mark Hamill in this. I thought it was really fun.
You can definitely see the beginnings of the Joker in how he is playing the Trickster. As you're watching the episode, there's little turns of, you know, the way he speaks certain phrases, and you're like, oh, that sounds just like the Joker from the animated series. Really good.
The laugh. Every time I heard the laugh, I was like, there he is.
Yep.
The other thing I thought about Mark Hamill in this, when he came on screen as the FBI guy, I thought two things. One, the makeup is awful.
Yeah.
If the makeup had been better, he could have totally pulled that off.
Oh, yeah.
Just did an amazing job of being the other guy.
Yeah.
You know, I just was like, this is a cool moment because the show is campy and over, you know, a little bit pushed all of it. But this moment is so great.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I expected him to be named, yeah, Agent Mustache Chin Putty.
Well, obviously, I mean, you guys were saying before that, I mean, the Trickster worked as an FBI agent, right? So maybe this is some sort of homage to that.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
He did indeed. That's so fun. Oh, my gosh.
So we've got one other new character that was introduced this episode. Now, I don't know if this is going to be a character that it keeps coming back, because we've had a character exactly like this already. We have a character called Joe Klein, okay, played by Richard Belzer. He's like the on-air television person, you know, always like, you know, trying to like just like tabloid talk, basically. And then in this episode, we had Arthur Klein show up, played by Tim Stack. I don't know if you guys know Tim Stack. Kind of a character actor. I know him from Son of the Beach, which I thought, because I thought it was a funny show. But he shows up as Arthur Klein and seems to be like, he's like asking the same questions that Joe Klein has been asking the whole series so far. And I'm wondering if we're going to see Joe Klein again, and if this is just a replacement or what's going on here.
Oh, yeah. If that actor suddenly became unavailable or they didn't want to work with him. And they...
Right. Exactly.
Yep. Yep. Yeah. Who
that
knows?
Has never happened in the history.
Never. Not once.
Val Kilmer.
But, you know, I guess sticking with the Trickster storyline, I mean, he's quite menacing here. And, you know, so far in the show, we've seen some menacing characters, but I don't think we've ever had a character that comes in and just, like, straight up murders people. And, like, they actually talk about it.
I'll tell you, that was one of the things that really struck me rewatching this, is I was like, you know, for such a light kind of 90s jokey show, the body count was pretty high.
Mm-hmm.
Walks by and like pats the guy who's hanging from the ceiling. I was just kind of like, ha ha.
Straight up shot that policeman in the back through the car seat.
Like, yeah. this is getting grim.
Well, and then his insanity, right? He ends up at the one of two dozen prop warehouses in Central City. And
he could be anywhere.
And he has this picture of Megan Lockhart on this costume, and suddenly he thinks that she is his long-lost sidekick named Prank.
Right?
Right.
He's only just invented the Trickster persona, so, I mean, this level of insanity is, for lack of a better term, crazy.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. I feel like the Trickster in prison writes a lot of fan fiction.
I did, as crazy as this episode was, and there were moments, you know, where we all went, oh, come on, why is that happening? But the beginning of it really set up how nicely crazy he was when he's got the mannequin set up as an audience, and then one of them comes back to him, so he shoots it. You know, you just immediately go, okay, nuts, you know, dangerously nuts, yeah.
Yeah, it was a great setup. I love that scene, too, with the guy heckles him, and he's like, oh, yeah, take this. Boom, shoots him.
Well, I wanted to know why he had that set up, like that recording, just so he could shoot somebody?
Yeah.
I feel like to be a true artist, you have to make peace with critics.
There you go.
Constructive criticism. That's his outlet.
Yeah, he had to get rid of Megan, so he was going to do it during a show.
I'll tell you one thing I really have to voice that I have not watched this show in many a year. I had gotten so used to the visual effects of The Flash that we watch.
Oh, yeah.
The 90s running effect sure was something.
We've talked about that, yeah. Corey especially.
I don't remember which moment it was where he was doing something and I was like, that's not even like super speed. That's like slightly faster than I do things.
Yeah, Corey's mentioned the effects a couple times about the super speed effects. It's for the time it was great, but like looking back now, it's like, yeah, nope, doesn't hold up.
Right.
Well, I think we've come to the conclusion that when they show the super speed, they're not showing it in real time, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Because of reasons and, you know, problems with the effect. Because of reasons.
I think you're right. My favorite was how he super sped over to where she was and got her out of the coffin, and then normal speed lifted her out, set her down, and then super speed untied her. Like, I'm going to take a break right in the middle here.
Right.
Exactly.
Eat some ding-dongs or something.
So funny.
Well, and speaking of Megan Lockhart, I mean, even their, you know, quote-unquote sex scene, or maybe, like, lead up to sex scene.
Oh, we all know what happened.
Yeah. And thank goodness Barry has a wall full of pink light-up glass right next to him. Is this the romance hallway, Barry?
Yeah.
No, I definitely had a moment of like, you know, I was a kid, like I was a teenager in the 90s. My ass didn't look like this.
It was designed for romance scenes. But keep going. We interrupted you, Corey.
But no, they discussed the Philadelphia story at the beginning. Has anybody seen the Philadelphia story?
I have not.
Nope.
Well, I haven't seen it either, but Tina does describe it as a woman trying to choose between two men played by Cary Grant and Jimmy Stewart, right? Which I think is kind of the reverse here of like Barry with Megan Lockhart and Tina McGee.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
Definitely.
And this is actually a new hairstyle for Tina McGee, by the way.
Yeah.
She's gone, like, we're in 1991 now, so she really has the 90s her hair up. And it's a bit, you know, messier. Like, she's put some mousse through it or something. And I think she's trying to look a
this
bit sexy.
This is dangerous, Tina.
Yeah, the all-girl gang, remember?
So, right? Yeah. Setting it up.
So, I mean, you know, they're really setting it up. And I think for a 90s TV show, again, like just going back to the level of murder in this episode, they get quite overt with the sex.
I thought so too.
I mean, they don't of course show it, you know, this isn't, you know, those right. channels.
But really, yeah.
What channels?
It's not HBO about, that's what I'm saying.
Late Night Flash. Yeah,
we call that one The Flesh.
No.
Oh, I'm sure there's one out there like that already.
But they were very blatant about it, even at the end when Barry says, let's just go back to my place so we can say goodbye. At the end, and you're like, hey, that's code.
And she gave him a nice little pat on the butt. Which was, you know, that was as far as you could go back then.
Well, they play it kind of realistic as well, I have to say. You know, I think, I don't know about you guys, but I think we've all been in that moment where you're kind of sitting on the couch together going, so what do you want to do now?
Right? Sleep on the floor. Right, exactly. Yeah, it was. I thought they did it well. I was surprised, though, at how sort of blatant it was. Yeah.
Yeah. That's no subtlety there.
I have to bring up, too, Corey, we were talking about one of the things that seems like it has not changed in, what is it, 27 years now?
Oh, man, yeah.
is that Joe and I, in the three seasons of talking about the new Flash, we would complain all the time about how people can get away from Barry Allen.
Oh, my God.
For no reason whatsoever. You know, we joke about his biggest nemesis being corners, right? All somebody has to do is get around a corner and, oh, I can't find them, they're gone. And it made me laugh because it was the exact same challenge in this episode a couple of times where I was like, you're faster than anything ever. Just run around real fast and find. They're right there. Like, Trickster is dragging away a full-grown woman who doesn't want to go, and you just broke out of a tank 12 seconds after he left the room. You can catch him. Like,
there was a moment, even when the Trickster had the ball bearings, where I was like, Barry stopped and watched the ball bearings hit the ground for, like, 30 seconds before he actually chased after him. It's like, Barry, you just go around him, buddy. There's a sidewalk. You'll be fine.
I did the exact same thing watching it. I was just like... Run around it, maybe. I don't know.
You saw them happen. They're not invisible.
You can see them right there. Oh, but still, I have to say, I loved the effect of him on the marbles.
Yes.
Getting around was pretty funny, pretty great.
And then, of course, the big climax to the episode, the showdown at the, you know, happenstance policeman's costume ball.
Right, with the multiple flashes.
Yes, with the multiple flashes, which I thought was quite funny.
That was pretty great.
And I also loved that none of the Flash costumes were even close.
I know, right? Murphy's was like Elvis Flash.
There were. Ah, that's great.
And of course the Trickster, I mean, like, he's got some interesting, you know, things that he does, right? You know, it's not so much that they're traps or attacks on the Flash. It's just like, I've got a statue that blows up, and I've got a cake that also blows up.
Right. Like,
but it doesn't seem like in a deadly, like, the statue seemed quite deadly, right? Like, it was like laced with some sort of fuel or something, and everything around it set on fire, whereas the cake kind of just like blows up in your face, and all you get is cake on your face.
One of the things I noticed that made me chuckle, though, in the Flash season one, our Flash, the episode Tricksters, where we got reintroduced to the old Trickster and the new Trickster, the final confrontation happened at a big gala, and do you remember how the Trickster got in? Disguised as catering.
Yep.
That's right. That's right.
I was just like, wow, he is a one-trick pony. This is like his one thing.
I couldn't get past the fact that he releases a gas in there, and then he's walking around with the gas mask on. I'm just like, Joker in Batman 89,
right,
anybody?
Right?
Right.
And that he's got his girlfriend / sidekick tied up under the table without a gas mask.
He told her not to breathe. Right.
Yeah, he said, try not to breathe, and then walked away. I'm like, okay.
Oh, too funny. His plan was not very solid, I have to say. Release tear gas and then blow up a cake at the Flash. That was his plan.
Really.
It was well thought out.
Well, that's what I mean. And the Flash takes him down pretty easily. I mean, with this juggling thing, of course.
Right.
To go with the theme. But yeah, at the end of the day, like, the Trickster was really no match for Barry. So, like, when he actually can corner him, like, he's done for.
Right. Yeah. Right. And it was funny, too. At the end, watching, you know, the craziness of him come back as he's getting carted off and he's yelling, I'm the Flash, that's my costume, you moron. And you just go, oh, you poor guy.
I hope that's the Trickster's catchphrase the next time, because I think he's going to show up again, right?
Yep.
He does show up again towards the end of the season.
I hope his catchphrase is just, you morons.
That would be excellent.
I have to admit, there was something funny about hearing crazy old man voice coming out of 20-something Trickster. Same voice. You morons.
Yeah.
Get off my lawn.
But he did good with the cartoon stuff, like Mark Hamill.
Oh.
Like, I think he jumped up on the stage at one point and went, here's something you'll really
that,
like.
Yeah, that was great.
all that stuff was really cool. And I love Mark Hamill. I'm a huge fan. He when he wants to chew the scenery, man, he does it. The other note, Tom, you were talking about the notes you took. The other note I took is he is swerving all over the road while he's driving.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God, yeah.
I mean, like, turning all the way from, you know, 9 and 3 to 12 and 6 each direction.
And yet the car doesn't seem to be moving, just the steering wheel. As he drives around in the most inconspicuous bad guy vehicle you could ask for.
Oh, my God.
It's like, are we really having that difficult a time finding this guy? Look at that thing.
The Trickster Mobile.
The Trickster Mobile. Oh, so much fun. It was really fun to go back and watch this again.
And we do have one last point here as well.
It sort of doesn't fit into the main storyline, but it's something that sort of has come up in other shows as well. It's Lieutenant Garfield says to Barry, he says he believes that maybe the Flash is the reason we have these guys like the Trickster and the previous guys that he's been fighting. You know, that's something that's been discussed a lot, you know, in comic books and, of course, in the current Flash series where the particle accelerator is the reason for the villains. But in this, I don't know, in this take so far, I don't know about. I mean, obviously the Flash did create the Trickster in this episode, but some of the other villains, they existed before the Flash.
Right. Well, and it's funny because when he was talking about that, I was thinking about how that gets discussed in the new Flash series. But I remember, again, I haven't watched a lot of the Flash 90s since then, but one of the things I remember thinking about it was, where are the supervillains? Felt like he did a lot of taking down of drug lords and, you know, kingpin crime guys, but not a lot of supervillains, the kind that we're used to seeing with superpowers, you know.
Right.
I felt the same way watching the show as a kid, being kind of like, but where's the bad guys?
Yeah.
Correct if I'm wrong, the only three bad guys I remember showing up on the 90s Flash, of like the classic Flash villains, are the Trickster, Captain Cold, and Mirror Master, right?
Yeah, you got it right. That's it.
And he fights a weird, what is the blue version of him?
His name was Pollux.
Have you gotten to that? You haven't gotten to that one?
Not yet. No, that's coming up.
Not yet.
That's what I thought, yeah. I remember that one. I don't even remember.
I totally forgot about that.
Mirror Master from the 90s.
That's David Cassidy.
Oh.
Yep, David Cassidy stars as the Mirror Master, yep.
Greasy ponytail.
No, it's so much fun. Yeah, it's a great point that they really do pursue a lot in the new Flash is, you know, does having the superpowered villain draw, or the superpowered hero draw the super villains to town? And
exactly.
Do the town people want him there because of that, you know?
It'll be interesting to see, because I don't remember how the Mirror Master and how Captain Cold actually come into play in the 90s series. I don't know what their origins are, if they're similar to the comics or what. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays into this whole discussion with Garfield and all.
Well, I totally agree. I've been saying, as we've been watching, that they've sort of slowly escalated the bad guys so far, you know, just starting from like lower end, like biker gangs to mobsters and stuff like that. Now we're here, we're kind of at the Trickster, and I'm hoping going forward that we're going to see some more superpowered ones. I mean, the Trickster's not really superpowered, but he is a known Flash bad guy.
Yeah,
so. And he's got a costume.
Exactly.
So, yeah, from what you guys are telling me, we're going to see a few, and then they're going to make up some as well.
Yeah. I believe that's right.
Yeah.
But no, the show definitely...
It should be interesting.
It's definitely the villains of the week there were frequently just kind of... bad guys.
Yeah, generic.
So I think all in all, I think we're all kind of saying that even though it's kind of cheesy, it's still a lot of fun.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Nostalgic cheese fun.
That's so much fun.
Really,
truly. And the moments that make you go, what? I don't know what that means. But I loved it. You know, I wrote down a quote from Megan Lockhart at the end of the episode when Barry was talking. They were talking about how, you know, is he bringing villains to the city or whatever? And she said, it's a dirty job, but hey, babe, at least you got the suit. And I went, I don't understand what you're saying, right?
Everybody flirts differently, Tony.
I think he says that he likes what she's wearing, too. And I'm like, that's weird, because she's pretty much wearing what the Trickster wears.
Right. Oh, that's right. That's right.
Is there some subtext there?
Back to the room of pink glass.
Oh, too fun.
All right. Well, thank you for joining us, guys.
Yeah, definitely.
For this discussion. It's great to have you. Maybe we could work it out for the next Trickster episode. You know?
Let's talk. Maybe. Let's figure out our schedules. That's fun.
Awesome.
We had a good time.
Great to have you.
Thanks
back.
For having us, you guys.
No, we appreciate it, definitely.
And now for our final conflict, you crimson miscreants. Your days in Central City are numbered.
I'm not the Flash, you dipstick! A decoy?
Pathetic! Nobody tricks the Trickster!
We need some air out here. Something stinks.
I knew you were coming, so I baked a cake.
Oops. Don't know more.
This isn't the real prank. You've substituted a robot in her place. I can cut her and she won't bleed. I double dare you.
Enough! I'm sick of this cartoon crap!
Magic's never been my strong suit. But juggling is a snap.
Oh man, it's so great having those guys on the show. Right?
I know, you know, it's funny. I was like, for a little bit there, I was just awestruck because I've been listening to them for, you know, the whole three seasons of the Flash so far. It's like I'm meeting a celebrity,
and it's great to hear that they've got a couple of new hosts.
Oh yeah, in definitely talks
to take over CCU, so the podcast will keep going.
Exactly.
All right, well, let's get into the feedback.
Well,
not really feedback as such, but you know, we've got a couple of things we'd like to maybe throw out there to our listeners.
Yeah. We got an idea. So I was looking on iTunes just today, and I was like, man, we have not got a review since 2015. That's two years ago. 2 years ago.
It's kind of our fault. I mean, we do throw out there that we like to get them, but
right.
We haven't really been actively, you know, pushing for it.
Exactly. So we have an idea, you know, and we're thinking now. There's another podcast that I got the idea from, but basically the idea is for all you guys listening right now, if you would go over to iTunes, give us a review, you know, write a little something, give us a 5-star review. What we'll do is for every new 10 reviews that we get, we'll have a little drawing. Okay, of those people for every group of 10, and we'll give you a free digital comic book, you know, of your choice, something like that, just to thank you for taking the time to go over and review the podcast. Because that when you guys review the podcast, that really does help our, you know, us to get noticed a little bit over there.
And of course, we're not going to, you know, go like super high on price wise,
right, yeah,
you know, we'll put it like a, you know, $3 or $5 limit on it,
yeah, like, hey, a typical, yeah, typical issue, you know, typical normal issue that comes out. So yeah, something like that, you know, just a little thank you if you would please give us a review and a rating over there on the iTunes thing, you know.
Yeah, especially now that we're on GSM, you know, our new home, so we'd really like to build up some good rating reviews, get the word out
exactly
about the podcast, you know, where we really want to try and take it up a level. And the easiest way you guys can help us is with iTunes reviews.
Definitely.
Or podcast reviews in general, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
The other thing we wanted to mention was that Facebook has kind of put in this thing now where you can have like two people on Facebook Live. It's for, you know, phones only at the moment, for the phone app.
Mm-hmm.
But we figured maybe we could live stream our recording.
Yeah.
Right? Do, you know, so you guys can tune in. I mean, it won't have any of the music, and of course we don't play the clips, like it all gets edited in later.
Right.
But we thought maybe if we Facebook Live, you guys can show up and, you know, interact with us, you know, and really kind of throw out your thoughts while we're recording, and we could sort of incorporate that into the show. So yeah, we're setting up a Facebook group. It is live now, facebook.com/groups facebook.com/rewatchpodcast. So you guys can come over and you can actually post your own stuff and we can create discussion threads and all kinds of stuff. And we thought it might be a bit more of an interactive way to get listeners into the rewatch with us
exactly.
while we record. So if you guys want to do that, facebook.com/groups/rewatchpodcast and get involved, you know. Yeah. And like I said, we're going to live record and you kind of get the episode maybe even a bit early, kind of.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We're probably not going to do it for every episode, you know, but we'll definitely work it out. We can do it a couple times, hopefully, if it all works out and we get some good comments and interaction, definitely something we would want to keep trying to get in there.
Exactly. Yeah. Just not in all the time, but you know, sometimes, and we'll let you guys know when we're gonna do
yeah.
it to give you a bit of a heads up. So that would be cool. Awesome. All right, so next week's episodes, we're going to be discussing Tina, Is That You? And Be My Baby. Now, I think, well, we've already kind of had an insight to what Tina, Is That You?
Yeah.
Is all about, right?
Some kind of Tina backstory and about a gang or something. I'm wondering if we're going to see like a bunch of her like college friends or something like that come back to town. And I don't know. So we'll say, Be My Baby. I don't know. Did they leave like a baby on their doorstep and say, this is your kid from the future? And I don't know. Oh, yeah, Lois and Clark. Sorry, that's Lois and Clark.
I know. Honestly thinking, like, when I saw the two titles, like, not knowing what Tina, Is That You was about before we discussed it today, and then Be My Baby, I kind of thought maybe it was going to be the progression of Barry and Tina's relationship, right?
Right. Yeah, I guess I could see that. Yeah, true. But now we know that's supposed to come before this current episode where they kind of did establish that they're just friends, you know?
Well, Be My Baby could still be that, right? If that's supposed to be afterwards.
I guess it could be. Yeah, I guess it could be.
So not literally baby, but baby is in like...
Right, yeah, like mothers. Girl, yeah. Like honey, like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
Term of endearment, that's what I'm
exactly, thinking. There you go. Yeah, so, well, whatever it is, we'll find out next week because that is it for this episode of the Rewatch Podcast. So head on over to goldenspiralmedia.com/apple for more great podcasts from Golden Spiral Media. And don't forget to join us on Facebook at facebook.com/rewatchpodcast and then over on Twitter at rewatchpod. And like we said earlier, your rating and reviews always appreciated on your podcast app of choice.
Well, as always, thank you for joining me for these episodes, Tom.
Yep.
Been fantastic special edition with special guests and everything.
Exactly.
A lot of fun.
This one should be like double bagged and like, you know, lenticular cover and everything.
I know. Well, that'll just leave me to say until next time. You know, I've mastered all of Houdini's secrets.
We gotta run.
Golden Spiral Media and the Rewatch Podcast are not associated with Pet Fly Productions, Warner Brothers Television, or Warner Brothers Television Distribution.
Come on, let's go down to Burger World so I can get some beef.
The use of any and all copyrighted material is solely for parody, news, analysis, critique, or educational purposes, as provided in United States Codes Title 17, aka Fair Use.
I don't believe you! You're still worried about your experiment, about your life's work?
Music provided by Kevin MacLeod at Incompetech.com.
If all else fails, we can always go to Vegas.
Copyright 2017, Golden Spiral Media.
Hey, what's your hurry? You got someplace to go?
Thank you.